Belinda presents this unabridged recording of Power of Balance, written and read by Dr. Kerryn Phelps.
For Jackie, her unflinching compassion, courage, and tenacity in the face of so many challenges over the years is an eternal inspiration. The Power of Balance. We could scarcely believe it was finally over. Sitting in the Speaker's Gallery in the Australian House of Representatives on 7 December 2017, the day of the successful marriage equality conscience vote, surrounded by fellow activists, my wife Jackie and I had flashbacks of the struggle over two decades. The rallies, the marches, the personal attacks, the setbacks, and the endless meetings and interviews and speeches and opinion pieces had all led to this day, to this moment. Less than a year later, I found myself unexpectedly back in the House of Representatives. This time, I was giving my first speech as a new Member of Parliament, having been elected by the people of Wentworth in Sydney's eastern suburbs, after a Liberal Party leadership coup ousted the Prime Minister Malcolm Turnbull, triggering a by-election nobody had seen coming. The government, now led by Scott Morrison, had lost its majority. I was one of the crossbench MPs who suddenly held the balance of power, and the political world and my personal world had shifted on its axis. One sparkling Sydney day around this time, I took my paddleboard out on Sydney Harbour. It was one of those exquisite days on the water when your mind can meditatively explore beyond the limits of the task immediately in front of you. A green and yellow Sydney ferry ploughed past, leaving a wake that stirred up the calm water. When you're standing on a paddleboard, an approaching wave is a signal to keep your knees bent to absorb the instability, and to paddle harder so you don't end up falling into the water. It was a matter of balance. In that moment, I began to ponder that strange expression, balance of power. What I intended to do with that balance of power was a question I had been asked repeatedly by journalists. Unlike the major political parties, I thought, independent politicians could influence the future of Australia in a way that is not about power. It is more about balance, bringing equilibrium to policies and debate about the future of our country. The power of balance. I have had a long portfolio career in medicine, media, medical politics, mainstream politics, and business. I have often lived in the glare of media attention, mostly invited, sometimes unwelcome. I have been on the outside and the inside of the political process. I have also been involved in fighting for change as an advocate and as an activist. In this, I am most often driven by a sense of injustice, a passion for a cause, and a determination to bring positive change that will help the lives of my fellow humans. Consider the symbolism of the scales of justice, representing the weighing of evidence and facts to decide a verdict. All doctors have to weigh up the evidence for the advice we give to patients, balancing the risks and benefits. Primum non nocere, first, do no harm. The next question is how to do the most good with the least harm. I am very pragmatic, and I try to be balanced in my approach to most things. Where there is room for negotiation, I try to find common ground. However, there are some positions and principles that are not negotiable, because the scales of justice are tipped too far in the wrong direction, or the stakes are so high that any compromise will have unacceptable consequences. If I have a very strongly held view on a matter of principle, as I did on marriage equality, then there is no middle ground. You either believe in equality or you don't. And if you believe in equality, then you must be in favour of marriage equality. So on that, I was unwavering. When you are fighting for a greater cause, you often put the cause before yourself. Again, you weigh up the personal effort and risk against the potential outcomes. Then there are the times when you just have to jump in feet first and hope for the best. Writing a memoir is a fascinating challenge. In looking back, you can revisit the fun, the excitement, the exhilaration, the victories. It also forces you to reflect on times in your life that were desperately sad, challenging, disappointing, or frustrating, or in which you made decisions that your older, wiser self may not have made. You will never have the chance to go back and change the actions you took at those sliding doors moments. You are forced to review your decisions and actions, right or wrong, through the retrospectoscope, while the benefits, or otherwise, of hindsight shed new light on old memories, reminding you of old scars. Writing a memoir also encourages you to look at the people who walked some of your path with you, followed you into the dark and uncharted places, had your back when the going got tough, hugged you when there were no words, and celebrated with you when you emerged into the light. For the sake of balance, there are also the people who, for their own reasons, did all they could to block your path or cause you damage. One thing I know for sure is that life is about learning. This audiobook contains many of the insights I have gained and lessons I have learned along the way. To learn, you must take risks and accept that sometimes you will falter or fall or fail. In taking those risks, you also give yourself the opportunity to grow. And from time to time, you come to realise that without participating and all the inherent risks that go with that, there would be no successes, no victories. There will always be darkness and light. There is no yin without yang. But we can learn as much from the negative as we do from the positive. That is the power of balance. Chapter 1. Sand Between My Toes. When I was a child, we didn't have digital cameras or memory sticks. We had black and white, later colour, film in our cameras, and you had to wait until the whole roll had been shot, then leave it at the Photoshop or the chemist to be developed. We would excitedly open the yellow Kodak envelope to see which of the photos were in focus, then decide which were worthy of placement in our photo album. We would buy corners to slip over each corner of the photo and then stick the photo carefully in place on the album page. Later, someone invented pages with a clear, sticky plastic film to protect those images that would one day become so precious and irreplaceable. Some of our photographs would be made into slides, then slotted into the carousel on my parents' old Hanamex projector. Family slide nights involved sitting by the projector with the still images of holidays or weekends or celebrations, providing the stimulus for the stories that would form our family's history. The best way I can describe my earliest memories is like a slideshow from that projector, flashes of moments that are in their own way highly significant, or that simply found their way into the parts of my brain that store memories for no particular reason. Some are dispassionate, while others evoke a surge of emotion, a chuckle, a tear, or an existential pain that repeats itself over and over decades later. Sitting down to consciously think about my childhood, apparently trivial memories start to flood in, taking on a new meaning. Moments like my mother teaching me how to sew from patterns so that I could make my own clothes on her Singer sewing machine. Or Auntie Shirley, my father's sister, teaching me how to knit like a right-hander, even though I was left-hand dominant. Or my father, after I had said I wanted to redecorate my bedroom, teaching me about plumb bobs, drop matches, and perfect pattern alignment so I could wallpaper the room myself. or decked out in maroon and white, barracking for the Manly Warringah Sea Eagles rugby league team at Brookvale Oval. Or later in my teens, learning to handle a manual car in my mother's green Volkswagen Beetle, practicing how to double clutch to shift gears and how to do a smooth hill start. My four grandparents were very much a part of my life through my childhood and teenage years. I remember my maternal grandfather, George Gunston, catching prawns in Narrabeen Lakes on a full moon and painstakingly teaching me how to untangle a fishing line. He was the youngest of six children. He had left school before the end of primary school and at the age of 9 or 10 went north with his older brothers to a huge outback station in northern Queensland where they were rounding up feral horses and training them. The tutor for the station owner's children gave him some tuition in the afternoons after he finished work. He returned to Sydney at 15, doing labouring jobs and driving. Despite his lack of formal education, he had a mathematical mind and a love of words. His ability to do rapid mental arithmetic at one stage scored him work at the racetrack calculating odds for a bookie. My maternal grandmother, Elsie Wellington, had lived in an orphanage from the age of 6 after her mother died in childbirth. It was not clear what happened to her father. She was kicked out of the orphanage when she turned 15 and was deemed old enough to work, starting night shifts in a wool factory. My mother, Shirley, was the younger of their two children. The family had insecure accommodation and were constantly forced to move because they had trouble affording the rent. My grandparents worked hard to make sure their children had the opportunities they did not have. Shirley met my father, George Phelps, at a dance in Punchbowl when they were both in their teens. They married a few years later and moved from Sydney's western suburbs to Manly Vale on the city's northern beaches, so that they could enjoy the Aussie beach lifestyle. My father was an active member of Queenscliff Surf Life Saving Club. Throughout my early life, I was told how much I was wanted after my parents had tried to have a child for years. I was born on a Saturday morning in December by caesarean section, after my mother's protracted labour failed to progress. I am told I was a spirited, curious, and strong-willed child. I had no interest in dolls or soft toys at bedtime, and from the earliest age that I could communicate it, I would want to go to sleep holding a book. Perhaps my earliest flash of memory is waiting in the car outside Manly Hospital with my father when we went to pick up my mother and my new brother Peter after he was born. My father, who had three sisters, was the only surviving son in his family. So Peter's birth was much celebrated as he would be the one who would carry on the family name. When I was about 4 years old, my parents decided to fulfil my father's dream of running a country pub. He liked a beer, though my mother never touched alcohol. They bought a hotel motel in Pambula on the New South Wales south coast. My father played in the local rugby league club. When the players and their wives came to the pub for dinner on the weekends, my mother would entertain them playing the piano in the bar. One of my memory vignettes is in the front bar of the hotel on Anzac Day, with the smell of beer in the air and the sound of locals playing two-up in the back room. To keep me occupied while my parents ran the pub, I unofficially started at the local primary school. I was already reading, so I'm told I took to school like a duck to water and didn't look back. We also had a pet cow, who had apparently come with the pub. Her name was Lindy Lou, and she lived in our backyard. It was a big backyard. The local policeman taught me how to milk her. Lindy Lou was not just any backyard cow. She won a ribbon in the local Marimbula show, no small achievement, and to celebrate she was invited into the front bar while the locals toasted her with a beer or two. Being the active child that I was, the local doctor in Pambula had to stitch me up once or twice. As legend has it, Dr. John Yeo even had to tend to our dog when he got distemper because there was no vet in town. Life can create strange, inexplicable coincidences. After my preclinical years in medical school, I was assigned as a medical student to Royal North Shore Hospital in Sydney for our clinical training. Teaching hospitals can be daunting, and the university had a mentoring program that randomly assigned a senior clinician to each junior medical student so that we would have someone to contact for guidance or advice. My mentor? Who else but Dr. John Yeo, who by then was head of the spinal unit at Royal North Shore. Our country pub experience only lasted a couple of years before we were back in Sydney. My father joined the Newport Surf Club, and I started school.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.